Thank you, Lady Mayor. Ladies and gentlemen, my friends, when I was told I was to speak to you about the composer of the verismo school, I was horrified. To address a gathering of musicians, opera lovers, critics, even friends, on the subject of the... On the subject of the great Italian composers of this century that I had the honor to know is impossible. Most of you here know far more about this composer than I do. I could hastily read some of the dry facts about each person, tell you when he was born, what he wrote, and when he died. But you all know those things. Then I was reassured. You knew most of these men, Giovanni, I was told. People don't want to know that Puccini wrote 12 operas, or that Giordano was 81 when he died. They want to know personal stories about each of these men. They want to hear the behind-the-scenes stories, which only you as an artist can tell. With this, I took heart. I was never an intimate of any one of those men. I venerated the older of them. And when I was an established artist, they were established too. We met in course of our work, and then parted to continue other work. Yet, I can tell you a bit about many of them. Some of the stories you may know. So please bear with me. Others, I think you will hear for the first time. Let's start with Puccini, because he was the first great composer I knew, and he was probably the greatest of them all. In 1910 and early 1911, I was singing Verdi's Hernani, my debut, and Marchetti's Ruy Blas, at the Teatro Dal Verme in Milano. I had been quite successful in both operas, and the word was beginning to get around that young upstart Martinelli may not have had much experience, but he did have a strong pair of lungs. One day, the theater manager, who was also my sponsor, told me that I was to sing an audition for someone. I came out on the stage, looked up into the darkened auditorium, and saw no one. A voice asked what I would like to sing. As I recall, I chose Celeste Aida and Cielo e Mar from La Gioconda. When I finished, two men came up on the stage, and my heart stopped. I was only at the threshold of my career, but all Italy knew Arturo Toscanini and Giacomo Puccini. Puccini was then 53 years of age, fairly tall and thoroughly masculine in appearance and in voice. He grasped my hand heartily and said, "Bravo, young man. I think you will do." He turned to Toscanini, who began to question me on my musical training. Then the explanation was given to me. La Fanciulla del West, the girl of the Golden West, had its world premiere at the Metropolitan the previous year, in 1910, with Caruso, Destin, and Amato. The European premiere of the opera was to be given at the Teatro Costanzi in Roma, in the summer 1911. Eugenia Burzio was to be Minnie, Amato Jack Renz. Amedeo Bassi was to sing Johnson, the role Caruso had created, but he was available only for the premiere and would have to leave immediately afterward. As a matter of fact, he came here to London for the coronation of the King George V. Puccini and Toscanini were seeking a replacement for Bassi. I was to be the replacement. I went to Roma and started to study the score with an assistant maestro. After some time, Toscanini summoned me. I sang for him. It was all wrong. Now I realize you might think that I'm speaking too much of Martinelli and have departed from the original subject of the lecture. But I'm telling you of my own experience, and because of this, I must digress and explain at various times. You must understand that as an embryonic singer, I had been trained almost exclusively in the bel canto school. My first operas were Hernani, Ruy Blas of Marchetti, and a lyric work by Rossini, his Stabat Mater. I had still to learn how to use the art of declamation without, in any way, impairing the lyric line or the long outstanding legato phrases, which are the very essence and heart of the bel canto school. Dramatic declamation, as found in the verismo school, or even in the Otello of Verdi, is an entirely different method, and while one can complement the other, it is essential that the voice be set perfectly before attempting such a diversified repertoire, or an unfortunate singer can reach a point where he is unable to sing a line without a wobble or to declaim and stay on pitch. So, when I originally started work on the fanciulla, I knew only the art of bel canto, and except for the phrases, quello che tacete me l'ha detto il cor, or the other more famous, quella mi creda libero e lontano, for the tenor, and really also for the soprano and baritone, the fanciulla is made up of dramatic declamation. I found this especially difficult at first, and was more inclined to sing phrases which should have been declaimed. As I said, it was all wrong. The result? Toscanini's reaction to my deficiency. No, he said. This will never do. Very impatiently, he slammed shut the score. This man is too much of a conscripto for me. That is to say, he can make a good soldier, but he is not yet ready for the battle. In short, he meant that I might become a good Johnson for him, but it would take too much time for me to be prepared. We will have to get someone else, he concluded, as he turned away from the piano. My heart sank to the bones. I don't know where I got the courage or inspiration to face him immediately with a reassuring smile. Maestro, I said, maestro, you are perfectly right. I knew very well the importance of the task when I undertook this assignment. If you feel that I must be dismissed, I will return to my hometown, Montagnana, with sincere serenity in my heart, for, at least, in coming to Rome, I have had two great satisfactions: to have seen the eternal city, which is a dream of everyone from the provinces, and I always can say I have been a good hour at work with you. This little bit of genuine modesty performs a miracle. Immediately he began to smile at me. Then he turned to the assistant maestro and gave a direct order to proceed at once with this simpatico giovinotto. As he called me immediately, and he honored me with his friendship up to the very end of his life, the last day I was with him.
So the performance were given and all went well. Quite frankly, this Fanciulla Costanzi performance attracted directors from many countries. Hence my engagement in Monte Carlo, Budapest, Brussels, several cities in Italy, London and New York. To all of which Puccini came to observe the rehearsals and production details. To tell you more about our Puccini and how much he liked my Johnson, he insisted on having me in the La Scala production 2 years later, even though I did not appear to my best advantage in my first performance of De Grie in Manon Lescaut with Claudio Muzio at the Teatro Dal Verme in Milano a few months before La Scala Fanciulla premiere. He said to the manager, who were on the side whether or not to assign the role to me, he said, never mind. He sang 24 performances of Manon with Muzio, and I was very well pleased with him. As a matter of fact, Puccini came very often to attend these performances, and he told La Scala director, I am satisfied. Martinelli will be the Johnson I wanted. I encountered Puccini on many other occasions, when I was an established artist. He was always warm and friendly. Just a half century ago, he told me that if I continued to sing as I had been singing, I would have a longer career. I hope that he's looking down here tonight to see that this tradition can grow.